Today I will share with you 10 tips that will make your photo editing life a lot easier. But before we start, I got something amazing to tell you. I'm currently planning out an amazing photo manipulation course that will teach you literally everything you need to know in order to create whatever you can imagine in Affinity Photo. If you're interested in this, feel free to click the link below. It will take you to a page that I've created with more information regarding the course, including a course outline and a button where you can join the waiting list for the course. I definitely have to announce you this because there will be some amazing things coming up before the launch of this course. If you're interested in this, feel free to click the link below and let's continue to the Affinity Photo tips. Alright, so tip number one for you is how to quickly straighten an image with the crop tool. And this is fairly easy. I just shot this picture of my camper and I'm actually right here recording this video. And as you can see, this image is not perfectly straight. So how to fix this? I would simply have to press C on the keyboard to go to the crop tool. Another way to select the crop tool is by clicking this icon right over here in the tools panel. And all I would have to do is hold command or control depending on your operating system and click and drag a line along the horizon. So I assume that should be around here. And once I release my cursor, you can see that the image is straightened. Now, you can see that some white edges appeared right over here and here and here. So how to fix this? Go up to the context toolbar and make sure you choose your ratio. So I want to keep the original ratio. And all I would have to do is simply click and drag these points in so we wouldn't have any white edges along our image. All we have to do now is hit apply in the context toolbar, and this is how to quickly straighten your image with the crop tool. Alright, so the second tip I got for you is also a very useful tip, and I found out about this quite late, I have to admit, but I will share it with you today. So let's say I want to cool down this image a little bit. What I would do is go down here to my adjustment layers and create a white balance layer. Now I would drag this one to the left to cool down the image, and let's say I want to try to add some magenta. Well, this looks kind of interesting, maybe some green, not green I don't like, maybe magenta. Alright, so maybe later I think, nah, I don't want magenta at all, let's reset it. So there are some ways to get this slider back to zero, and the hardest way is by clicking it and sliding it back to 0%. As you can see, it will snap, but it is still a pretty time consuming and difficult way. The far easiest way to reset this slider is simply by double clicking the handle, and as you can see, it will snap back to 0%. So I can do my changes, look at it. No, I don't like it. Simply double click the slider and it will slide back to 0%. So the third tip I got for you today is how to see your live clipping. And what clipping actually is wait, let me actually show you. I'm going to create a levels adjustment layer by pressing Command L on the keyboard. And I'm going to move the black level slider all the way to the right till about here. And as you can see, many parts of our image have turned completely black and actually lost all its detail. If I would slide this one back to the left, you can see the detail back again. So how do we find out, or how do we know where and when clipping occurs? We can simply hold Option or Alt depending on your operating system. So I hold my Option key on the Mac. I click my black level slider and I move it all the way to the right until I see pixels appear. So as you can see, I see red pixels appear. And if I move further to the right, you can see that all these red pixels turn into white pixels. And once they are white, this means that they are pure black in the real image, let's say. So this is where we lost all our details. So let's hold Alt and Option again and move the slider back to the left to where it's not white. So this is the maximum point to where I can move my black level slider, because if I move it further to the right, clipping would occur. So now we can actually still see some detail in the darkest areas, and the same for the bright areas of our image. We can move this slider to the left and over here we would have clipping. So if we would hold Alt, you can actually see where the clipping occurs. So once we slide to the left and the pixels get pure black, this is where we lose our details. So to not overexpose your image, make sure to not move your slider too far and hold Option while sliding so you can actually see when the clipping occurs. So let me show you the before and this is the after. Alright, so the next cool trick I got for you is how to make selections with the brush tool. And I will have some following tips and tricks on how to perfectly make selections with the brush tool. So how to do this? Simply select the right layer. In this case, it's my background layer, and I would hit Q to enter quick mask mode. And as you can see, our screen has gotten this red nice overlay. So what we want to do is select the brush tool, which you can select right over here in the tools panel, or you can simply press this keyboard shortcut B on the keyboard. And make sure your foreground color is set to white. A quick tip, if you have any other color selected, let's say blue and black, simply press D on the keyboard to go back to the default colors, and you can toggle between the foreground and the background color by pressing X on the keyboard. So with white set as a foreground color, I can use the brush to make a selection of my snail. However, with the basic brushes selected, let's say this one right over here, if I would increase the brush size a lot to save some time, you can see that my line is not really nice. You can see that there is a lot of spacing in between my brush, which makes it really hard to make fine and nice selections of our snail. So how to fix this? With any brush selected, go up here in the context toolbar and click on more, and make sure the spacing is set to 1 to 5%, maybe at least less than 25%. So I will set it to 1 now, and you can see that once I make a line now, you can see it is a super smooth line. So this makes it a lot easier to make selections with the brush tool. Another great tip when selecting with the brush tool is that you can use any brush to make the selections. So let me undo this for now, and let me select one of my cloud brushes. So if I would simply select my cloud brushes, and let's increase the size a little bit. If I would click here to make this as a selection, and I would turn it into a mask, you can see that the selection actually is a nice cloud. I can also use my cloud painter brushes to increase or decrease or to add or to subtract from my selection. If I would paint in with black, you can see that I would subtract from my selection in the form of clouds. So you can use any brush or any brush setting to create your selections with brushes. And the last thing regarding brushes is that brushes make it really easy to blend in a subject with its background. So as you can see, I've got this penguin right over here. And if I would zoom in on his feet, you could see that this looks super weird because he is just like glued to the grass or whatever. It just looks super fake. So if we would create a layer mask and select the layer mask, we can use any grass brush, so these are just free to download from the internet. Make sure your brush tool is selected, and I decrease the brush size a little bit. Let me zoom in a little bit. Once I select black as a foreground color, I only have to click once, maybe twice. And you can see now it looks like the penguin is actually standing in the grass. So this is the power of brushes as well, of environment brushes to be specific. Now we've masked out parts of the penguin like this with the grass brush, and because this mask is clipped to the penguin, I can move the penguin around, I can move it wherever I want, and this grass would still be there. So I can also transform it right now, and it would still be realistic. So make use of brushes when blending in objects with their background. Alright, the next tip I've got for you is gonna save you a lot of time, and it will help you repurpose your cutouts. So as you know, making selections and cutouts in Affinity Photo is quite time consuming. So once you've done it, you want to make sure you save your selection. So as you can see, I've got my background right over here. This is a picture I shot in South Africa, and this is a picture of an elephant in South Africa as well. And as you can see, I've already made my cutout over here. So here's my selection of my elephant. And the great thing is, like, now I've made my selection once, I can go over to my assets panel, and as you can see, it's already right over here. But what I would have to do is make sure you have your elephant selected or any other object that you have cut out, and simply click and drag this over to your assets folder. So as you can see right now, I've got my elephant right over here. So if I would move this away, I can simply click and drag this elephant back to my document, and all of the cutouts are just as perfect as they were before. So you don't have to spend all your time again and again and again to reuse your cutouts. So once you've dragged it to your assets panel, you can right click it to rename it or to delete it. I can now delete it because I already have mine right over here, and you can categorize everything. So As you can see, I've got three categories: animals, random, and space. So here are some other assets that I've created, and the moon I've cut out. The moon is very useful, obviously, because it's easy to use in photo manipulation. So to create new categories, all we have to do is click this icon right over here and click create new category. And once we've created it, Affinity Photo will actually call it assets. But if we click here once again, we can rename it to whatever we like. So now you can see I have a new category right over here, and it will have a subcategory called assets. So if I would drag this one up here, you can see it would appear in this subcategory. We can also rename the subcategories by clicking this little icon over here and click rename. So I would call this animals or elephants or whatever. And we can also create new subcategories by clicking this icon right over here and create a new subcategory. So now we have another subcategory, and let's say I would like to have the moon in there. So let me drag my moon over here. And as you know by now, I would simply have to click and drag this moon right over here, and it would appear in my assets folder. So make use of assets. It will save you a lot of time. Alright, this is gonna be my last tip for today. I wanna thank you for watching all the way through, and I know you will love this one. It's all about snapshots. So snapshots are actually checkpoints that you create during your project. So you can actually save parts of your project in a snapshot. So how does this work? You can go up to View, go to Studio, and click Snapshots to open the Snapshots panel. Mine is already over here, and as you can see, in this project I've used 6 snapshots. So let's first talk about how to restore a snapshot. All I would have to do is simply click this little camera icon, make sure I've got the layer selected, and press this little camera icon with the arrow to restore my snapshot. So as you can see, Affinity Photo has remembered all the layers. It has remembered the exact layout, and this was just this moment in time when I created this snapshot. So now let's move to the second one. I would have to click this little camera icon, select the layer, and click to restore to snapshot. And as you can see, the whole layers panel changed back to this moment in time that I created this thumbnail idea, up to where I came up with the last version of my thumbnail. So how to add a snapshot? Let's say I create a new layer right over here, and let me add some grass for whatever reason in this image. And I would like this idea. All I would have to do is click this little icon right over here, which is called add snapshot. So if I click it, this dialog box will pop up, and I can simply give it a name. So by default, Affinity Photo puts in the date and time of right this moment. So if I would simply click OK, you see my snapshot right over here. So let me return to the 6th snapshot, which was this one. And if I would want to go to my new snapshot, I would click my little camera icon. I would select the layer and click this little icon. And as you can see, Affinity Photo has returned to my last snapshot. So make sure to use snapshot, because they're gonna save you lots of time, and you can just create several ideas and save all of them in one document file. You can simply save your document like you usually would do. So I would do it by pressing Command Shift S on the keyboard. I would name this project snapshots. And if I would open back my project, Affinity Photo would have remembered all snapshots. Alright, and that's it for today. Thanks so much for watching all the way through, and I hope you learned something in this video. And if you learned something, please give this video a like and let me know in the comments down below what you've learned. If you like my content, feel very free to subscribe to my channel. It would mean the world to me, and then I hope to see you in my next video. Peace.